Bueno, buenas tardes. Gracias por venir. Thank you everyone for coming. We are going to have now the last lecture in the set of conferences that we have sponsored for the Master in Smart Cities. We are just about to finish the course. And for finishing the set of conferences, we got today one very big lecture. I'm very happy to have Luca with us. Luca Oneto was born in Italy. He speaks English and Italian, not very well Spanish, but probably he can understand if you want to ask at the end of the presentation some questions in Spanish, probably he should be able to answer them. If not, I'll make some translation if I can. So Luca was born in Italy a few years ago, and he received a bachelor and a master in electronic engineering at the University of Genoa. And later in 2014, he received a PhD, a doctorate, also in the University of Genoa. He presented a thesis on learning based on empirical data. He has been working on artificial intelligence since the very beginning. Later, he became an associate professor in computer science first assistant professor in computer engineering at the University of Genoa, later associate professor in computer science at the University of Pisa, and finally, since 2019, associate professor, equivalent to our professor titular, at the University of Genoa. He got the qualification for the full professor at the Italian National System, la habilitación o la acreditación para catedrático. He received the Best Italian Young Artificial Intelligence Researcher Award in 2020. He has been involved in many research projects, not only with companies, also European projects, for instance, in the Age 2020 horizon. He has been co-founder of a spin-off, which is called Cenabyte. Cenabyte, working in artificial intelligence applications to industry. His main research topic is statistical learning theory, with particular focus on theoretical aspects of the problems of supervised and semi-supervised model selection and error estimation. And his second main topic research is data science, with particular reference to the problem of trustworthy AI and the solution of real-world problems by exploiting and improving the most recent learning algorithms and theoretical results. I had the opportunity to meet Luca when I was staying in Genoa in my sabbatical year in spring.
And close to my desk.
Yeah, and in 3 years ago, just at the very beginning of the COVID. And I'm very happy to have the opportunity to bring him here. He has been very brave to dare to fly from Italy to here with a lot of restriction and betting if there's going to make an infection in the travel. And finally, he decided to come, and I'm very happy. And I'm going to say thank you very much to Luca for staying here. You probably know that this is one lecture sponsored by Indra, in the Digital Society Chair, that we have the honor of directing. And I hope that you enjoy this lecture, and please feel free to make any comments and any answer at the end of the session, or interrupt Luca at any moment if he wants. Thank you for coming, Luca.
Thank you all for being here, and I'm honored to be here for this lesson. I didn't know what kind of audience I would encounter, so if for something is too difficult, let me know. If it's too simple, let me know, so I can proceed. Okay. I don't have to present myself anymore because the professor already did it. So I'm an associate professor at the University of Genoa. And my main topic of research are artificial intelligence, machine learning, and data science. So theory and practice, okay? In the sense that I'm enthusiastic in working on topics that have fundamental research questions, but also relevant industrial and real-world application. And so in my presentation, you will see both souls of my research. Maybe the most heavy one is the theoretical part, but there will be also nice slides at the end on the practical one, okay? So, what we will talk about in this presentation, we will try to talk a bit about machine learning, so the art of learning from data and this application with the good part, but also the bad part. So what are the problems that are there and that are rising in the last year that we didn't think about because we are engineers and we are not from humanities. But now we cannot disregard this problem anymore, and we need to compensate the problem that artificial intelligence created in the world. So, in this first part, I will try to show that learning from data is not a subject per se, but is inside the big picture that I will try to depict as much as I can. I will show you that learning from data is mainly about handling risks, obviously risks in the sense of mathematics that can be in some sense measured, and show and try to convince you that when you do research, it's important to have a theoretical background that allows you to find real results and not just tinkering, okay? Because most of the research in machine learning right now is just taking a library, a data set, press play and say, okay, it works, okay? And then people start to use it in practice and nothing works and nobody knows why, okay? So, let's start from the basic, okay? What we are talking when we do machine learning? We are talking about inference, okay? Inference is the way in which our brain, human brain, works. So we start from something that is in some sense given as true, and we try to extract new knowledge, okay? This definition of inference is given by a philosopher, Peirce, at the beginning of the past century. And philosophy is actually at the basis of the most new and important machine learning algorithm. For example, probably you heard about super vector machine. Super vector machine is nothing but the transposition of the idea of falsificationism of Popper. Okay? So the basic idea behind machine learning are from 100 years ago and are concepts born in philosophy. Because philosophy is the art of dealing with inference, okay? The way in which we reason about things and we try to extract information from things that we assume to be true. And inference, in the modern way of thinking about inference, is divided in three possibilities, okay? The one that you are more used, but not because of your nature, but because in the schools they teach things in this way, is deduction. We start from a representation of the world, so we assume that there is a rule that governs the world. For example, there are beans in a box that are white. Then we extract a bean from the box, and then we can extract a new knowledge. This bean is white. For example, theorem proving is exactly a process of deduction. We start for some assumptions that are given as true, and then we try to prove by deduction a new information, which is the proof of the theorem, or the statement of the theorem. The second way in which we learn as human is induction, in the sense that instead of starting from a model of the reality, we observe the reality. And so we try to observe the input and the output of a system, and we try to induce how the system behaves. So to try to learn the rule that governs that particular system that we are observing. This is something more related with the so-called scientific discovery. Science works in this way. We observe the reality and we try to model the reality. Okay? But actually, the way in which we actually extracted new information and what are humans are good about, it's abduction. Abduction is trying to understand what would be the input that I have to give to the system to make it work like I want. So I need to both observe the output, induce the model that creates that results, and then find a way to construct an input to the system that makes the output as I want. Simple example, how can I show to people a particular product in order to force them to buy the product? Okay? Another example, how can I set up a machinery in order to reduce the number of faults? Another example, how can I present the feed in Facebook in order to increase the engagement of the user? Okay? This is abduction. And obviously, it's the way the humans reason, no? Because in the real world, when we talk with someone and we want to convince them to say yes to an answer, we try to understand how their brain works in order to ask the question in a way that will produce as answer yes. Okay? Now, risk. When we do these three kinds of reasoning in the real world, obviously we have to deal with two kinds of risks. Okay? The first, the risk that we usually don't care about is the computational complexity. In the sense that obviously as human, we are not used to think about the computational complexity of an effort that we do, because our brain usually works in milliseconds, and so we don't think about that, okay? But when you have a machine in front of you, the machine works in a completely different way. It is able to do much more computation with respect to our brain, okay, in terms of amount of computation, but the computation that is able to do is something very simple, okay? This means that everything which is related to learning, for example, learning comes from a theory, which is the exact theory of Kolmogorov, developed in the beginning of the past century, which is a perfect theory of learning from data. The only problem is that it's not computable, in the sense that you cannot write a code on a machine, on a computer, which is able to deliver the result that you want. Okay? Maybe you heard about not computable things when you read some or you see the film A Beautiful Mind. Did you saw the film A Beautiful Mind? Some? Yes? No? No?
Yeah.
Okay. In A Beautiful Mind, there is the guy that apart from falling in love, blah, 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 okay, the main thing is that he became crazy because he was trying to solve the problem P versus NP, okay? And P versus NP is the complexity of a program inside a computer. P means that it can be solved in polynomial time. So if you double, for example, your data set, the time that is requested to the computer to solve the problem grows quadratically. Okay? Instead, if it is NP, it means that if you double the number of samples, it takes factorial in the number of something. So instead of taking 1 minute, it becomes 1 year. Okay? And there are programs that are not even computable. For example, the simple example of computable problem are you are in front of a PC, you have to decide if the program will stop or not. If there is a while true inside, you will never stop, and so it's not computable. Okay? And so, when we deal about risk in something that needs to be implemented on a PC, you have always to take to care about also computational complexity. These two things goes together when you take something and you try to implement it on a PC. And obviously, the computational complexity can be described in many ways, so in time of memory, so how much memory I need to resolve a problem, how much time I need to resolve a problem, so linear, sublinear, polynomial, non-computable. But at the end, we are engineers. We are not just simple scientists. So I don't really care about the complexity if I'm able to solve the problem on my PC. Okay? So sometimes even not polynomial problem are used in machine learning. For example, deep learning is a non-polynomial problem. Why? Because I have enough computational power and I am able to solve that problem on my PC. So even if it's not polynomial, who cares? I can do it. So let it be not polynomial. For what concerns instead, the risk is more complex, okay? Because the risk requires knowledge about probability, statistics, okay? In the sense that when we deal with data, the only language that we can use in order to be able to address the problem, okay, is to use the language of probability, because it allows me to deal with phenomena that are not deterministic, okay? So probability allows me to deal with non-deterministic fact, and statistics allows me to infer something from data about non-deterministic facts, okay? And the problem here about the risk is the fundamental question of machine learning is how many data do I need in order to be able to solve a particular problem, okay? And so there is a so-called asymptotic and finite sample bounds, in the sense that there are bounds that tells me, in order to solve this problem, you need at least 1 million samples, a bound, less than 1 million samples. Or if I see an error, if I construct a machine, I can bound the risk of this machine, so the error that this machine will commit in real-world application. When you deal with deduction, the risk and the computational complexity is usually low, okay? Theorem proving is something that is easy to be implemented even on my PC, okay? Limited amount of computational power. And the risk is zero, because deduction is deterministic. The result is already in the premises. So in the hypothesis, that there is already the answer. The only thing is that is not explicit, okay? Another example of deduction is, for example, planning and scheduling, okay? So you have a set of constraints, you have an objective function to optimize, and you need to, for example, set up the room for the student for the next year, okay? This, for example, has zero risk, but the computational complexity is a bit higher because, for example, this is a non-polynomial problem. But in 2 hours, you can solve, for example, all the time schedule of the University of Genoa, okay? So nothing with respect to the power needed in induction, where the risk is high because you are trying to learn something from the data, so you can make mistakes, but also the computational complexity is higher. Why? Because, for example, the neural network that are behind Google Image have been trained for years on millions of samples on the infrastructure of Google, which is a city like Seville with a nuclear industry, on the side, okay? But you are an electric engineer, so you know better than me those stuff, okay? Instead, in abduction, it's crazy, because problem is about risk and computational complexity. You have the same risk as above, plus others. Because you are trying, for example, in abduction, to construct a molecule which is able to cure a particular disease. So you assume to know the model of the human body, and then you assume to be able to model how the molecule behaves on a particular disease, okay? And the computational complexity, obviously, is much higher because the number of constraints becomes huge, okay? Let's make an example of what I said. These are samples, okay? Very simple example. I need to classify the red points and the green points, okay? Then I do a learning phase. I construct a model which is able to discriminate between red and green, okay? Second part, another sample arrives, I can use the deduction phase, the forward phase, in order to say that this is a red point, okay? And then I want to abduce what kind of sample exists in the red space that is labeled red. Then I need this other constraint, because obviously the points do not lie inside the whole space. Imagine that these are humans. Maybe this human does not exist. Humans are just in this subspace, okay? And then when I want to generate a point, I need to generate this point taking into account the model, but taking into account also how the points behave. So this is an example of induction, creation of the model, deduction, labeling a point, and abduction, creating a point for which the label is the one that I want. Okay? You see that this problem is of increasing the complexity. And so, in a simple language that maybe you are more used to, you have a system which is unknown, you want to create a model, the deduction phase is the one that is able to take the input and using the model predict the output of the system. The induction phase is the one that, looking at some example of the input-output of the system, is able to create the model. This is the classical machine learning, whatever cursive machine learning gives this picture. And finally, abduction, instead, is the process of giving a particular output that I want, I need to create a model, and then induce an input that allows me to create the output that I want. Okay? Obviously, the risk of inference of the deduction is zero, okay? Because we just have to estimate the risk about the fact that the model that I look at may be, in some set, biased by the data that I have in my hand. So I take my model, I apply it on a series of data, the error is 1%, or I am happy, okay? Yes, but those data could be bad data in some sense. So I need to handle the risk that my data do not well represent the population. And so when I take my model and I apply it in practice, so I put it in production, instead of 1%, I see 20% of error. And then my chief will fire me, okay? Instead, in induction, I have to deal many more risks, because I have to deal with the same problem of deduction, because I have a risk of the fact that my model has been constructed from a finite number of observations. If those observations are not good, my model will be not good. The simple rule, garbage in, garbage out. Okay? The second risk is that I need to choose a good model for my data, the so-called Occam razor principle. Okay? My data can be explained with simple models or with complex model, okay? The more complex is the model, the more I risk that my model just works well with those data and not with the population. And the third risk that we have to handle is that maybe we are not able to learn that model, because learning that model would require too much computational power, okay? That I don't have, okay? Or the sample that I have are too much, and so I cannot use all those samples for training my model. And finally, the abduction, all the three risks that we have in induction are exacerbated by the fact that we have to generate an input that we don't know where it can live. For example, how it is possible to understand the human brain, if I want to detect how to produce an advertisement for a human, for him to like it. I need to model the human brain, which is my input, okay? And so this is completely risky, and I can fail in 100 million times. So now let's go a bit more into the details of what I said, okay? This is a strange math that you don't have to care about, but I put it because maybe you can look at it later. and it's just a standard way of representing things in machine learning. You have an input space, so an input to my system, an output, X and Y, okay, very simple. You have a data set, the data set. You have a function inside a set of functions. So you have a bag of functions for which you can select the one that you like. And the way in which you select this function is guided by the algorithm. For example, SVM. If you have a linear SVM, here are linear separator, here is a linear SVM, okay? You have the hyperparameters. The hyperparameters, what are the hyperparameters? Are, for example, in SVM, the kernel, okay? All of you knows what is an SVM, okay? Then you have a loss function, which is the function that you use to detect if your model is good or not. For example, in classification is the number of mistakes, okay? In regression is the mean square error. In SVM is the INGE loss function. Do you know the INGE loss function? Okay. And finally, you have two quantities, which are the key quantities in machine learning. One is the things that you would like to know, but you will never know, the true risk. So the error that your model will commit on the population. So the expected value with respect to the input and the output of the loss function, okay? Instead, what you have is the empirical risk. So the risk that you observe on your data. So the error that you see when you apply your model on your data, okay? So complex math, but at the end, simple things, okay? But unfortunately, a bit of math is useful, okay? So, first of all, when I do deduction, what is the problem? On the left, there is the population. Beautiful. If I have that, I can compute whatever I want, but I don't have it. I have the things on the right, okay? And so, I have to be careful because things that I measure here, the empirical risk, may be much different from the two risk. So, how far can be the empirical risk from the two risk, okay? The case of deduction, remember, is the case that the model is given by a counted. Basically, your professor arrives. This is the model. You have to check if it's good or not, okay? So you have a new fresh of data that has not been used for training the model, okay? And in this case, I need to find a way to bound this quantity. Instead, in induction, I have much more problems because apart from checking my model, I have multiple models to check, okay? So basically, I have a set of data and I need to train, so to select a function inside my bag of function that the bag of function is selected by me, for example, choosing between SVM or deep neural network or what other fancy algorithm, okay? And in this process, I have multiple risks. Because I have the approximation risk, which is nothing but the risk due to the choice of the set of function. I chosen the wrong algorithm, okay? It was not linear SVM, it was RBF, okay? So there is that blue error. Then there is a second error, which is the one related to my data. Let's suppose that the space of function is correct, but I have a limited amount of data in my data set. Okay? So I have an estimation error. So the error that I see of this model on my sample is different from the error of my model on the population. Okay? And third, I have another problem. I have the optimization error. Because when I search the best model inside my bag, I will not find the best one if the problem is non-convex, for example. Because if it's convex, I can reach the global minima, and so the best one. But if it's not convex, or you call Jesus, or whatever other god you like, or you will not find it, okay? Or even nothing if you don't believe in anything, okay? In abduction, let's not talk about it, okay? Because it would take one course to explain all the issue behind this, no? But here, obviously, there are errors everywhere. Estimation in two things, estimation of the model and estimation of the input, okay? You have approximation problem in the model and in the input. And you have optimization problem in the model, but also in the input, because imagine that you have to optimize the structure to meet of this molecule to meet the constraint of the chemistry. Okay? Easy peasy, no? Okay? They are working on this from 100 years, more or less, and they didn't manage to do anything, basically. Okay? You will, at least, I will not be able to solve it in my life. Okay? So, how can we handle the risk? Okay? And now I tell you some basic tools to deal with it. Okay? When you are in deduction, it's very easy, because there is a way, a technicality, that allows you to bound the distance between the empirical and the true risk with high probability, with a quantity that depends on the probability of your statement. Okay? This is a confidence interval bound, okay? In the language probably that you have studied these things. That goes down with the number of sample, usually 1 divided by the square root of the number of sample, the golden rule of statistics, okay? And it goes up as the delta becomes smaller, usually logarithmically, okay? The so-called exponential bound in what you have studied at the university, okay? But in order to make this statement, you need to assume this, the fact that your data, your sample, are IID, so independent and identically distributed. And then here follows the, in Italian we say qui cade l'asino, here follows the asino, I don't remember, the mule, okay, here goes down the mule, okay. Why? Because obviously IID is very good. When you put IID, you open books and there are 1 million formula to deal with everything, okay? You can make a consistency result, which means that your algorithm with enough sample will be able to learn. It tells us how we can sample the data and how we should sample the data if we have to design an experiment because you have a machinery and you want to collect the data in order to understand how it works. And it tells us also to construct the model, okay? So, beautiful. Problems. The IID hypothesis is always false, full stop, okay? There is nothing else to say, okay? But this forces us to make simplification. And this is also bad, because usually reality is not simple, okay? And then confirms a famous statement that is quite difficult to make prediction, especially about the future, okay? Because in the past we are able to do it, but in the future it's a bit complex, okay? But the ugly reality is that there is no real alternative, okay? Obviously, if here there was not me, but a mathematician, they would say, but no, there are plenty of alternative. There are, for example, the random walk, blah, blah, blah. And they say, yes, but there are 400 parameters that you have to set. Yes, but more or less. And then, okay, then I use IID, okay? And then practically it works. Why? Because when you ground your application on something that is theoretically grounded, you are able to measure how much your hypotheses are wrong, okay? And so, for example, if you are trying to do image recognition, for example, detecting a pedestrian in front of a car, you know that the samples are not independent and are not identically distributed. But then what you start to do? You start to observe the picture in front of the car for a long period of time. So in a longer period of time, there is more independence. On a different geographical area, so it's more independent, okay? Then it's identically distributed, no, but if I look at different lighting conditions, night and day, and then I observe all the situation and I extract randomly in this space, it's still not independent and identically distributed, but cars are going through the street of the US and they make less accident than normal cars, okay? So, true, it's not correct, the IID, but it's the only hypothesis that makes things work right now, okay? When instead you have to bound the risk of induction. So where I am? Okay, this one. Okay. What I need to do is to do something a bit more complex than doing simple statistics. Okay. So this is why of the picture at the beginning. Machine learning is not true. It's not only statistics. Okay. Is a statistical learning, okay? Because we have to deal with the risk of the fact that we have chosen our set of functions. So we are not just looking at the behavior of a random variable, okay? The error. But the error is guided also by the selection of a minimum, so the best model, inside the set of models, okay? And here, there are theories to bound each possible element, so approximation error, estimation error, and optimization error, okay? For example, for the theory of approximation, you can do something using the theory, the approximation error, using the theory of approximation. So proving that something is a universal machine or it's a Turing machine, okay? For the estimation error, you can use statistics. Instead, for the optimization error, you need to use some geometrical property, okay? Because, for example, two problems, one that I can solve in practice and one not, can be related by some geometrical thing that I can bound. Imagine the surrogate problem. When you have to solve something that has multiple minima, you approximate it with something convex, okay? And you solve the convex problem, okay? And then you prove that these two things under some condition are close to each other. But do we really care to estimate all these things? Do I really care to know how much approximation, how much estimation, how much optimization error I do? In theory, yes. But again, we are engineers. I don't care. I care just about this distance, okay? Because I care how much my model will be similar, the behavior of my model will be similar to what I will observe in practice. Because if this quantity is small, and this quantity is enough for my application, I don't care where I made a mistake, okay? Because people pay me, and so I'm happy, okay? So in this case, the bound is the same, is a high probability bound, okay? But instead of having just a risk due to the number of samples and the probability of your statement, there is another term, which is a measure of the complexity of this space, because what guides us at the end is the Occam razor principle. If the function that I check are simple, I have linear model, okay, there could be a linear model that in image recognition makes a small error on my data and big error on the population, but the chances are small, okay? Instead, if I use a deep neural network with 400 hidden layers and blah, 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 it's sure that it will not work as I see on my data, okay? But why? Because this term, which is the measure of the size of your bag of function, is completely different, okay? And so the risk that we have to bound are two, the learning risk and the statistical risk, okay? This is why statistical learning theory. Machine learning mostly deals with this, not with this, okay? How can we bound the complexity of a model? I could stay here again for 3 weeks teaching this. I wrote a book where I explain these 6 ways of doing it, okay? In your case, probably you know just one approach, which is not even inserted here, which is the cross-validation, the so-called splitting methods, okay? Which, unfortunately, does not give any information about this. Because when you split your data, you are always using a fresh set of data to test your model. So you are not measuring how you are learning from the data. You are just checking your deduction phase. So you did something, you created a model with a set of data, I kept some fresh of data apart, and I check how the model works on those fresh set of data. You give zero insight on the learning phase of your model, okay? Instead, these methods describes how you can try to understand how your model works, okay? Maybe you heard about the Wapnick-Chervonenkis theory. This, at least, because if you know SVM, SVM is due to Wapnick, and SVM is based on the Wapnick-Chervonenkis theory. But there are other approaches. For example, the algorithmic stability that now is gaining momentum because, for example, it is quite useful to study deep neural network. There are the compression bound that is quite useful because it is interesting when your model tries to compress the data. The more it compresses, the more it learns. There is the pack bias theory, which is able to deal, for example, with the random classifiers, okay? For example, the Gaussian processes, okay? And there are also methods, fancier, but very powerful, which are the differential privacy theory, for example, which is a theory that tries to maintain the privacy of the data while you learn the data itself, basically by injecting noise on the data, okay? But if you inject noise on the data, what happens? That the algorithm is not able anymore to fit the data because data are becoming more noisy than the original one, okay? And if you inject noise, you also protect the information. The larger is the noise, the larger is the protection against a violation of the privacy, okay? But if you can inject a big noise and the algorithm still behaves well, it means that the model is actually learning and is not just memorizing the data, okay? And finally, there is this new theory that came out a few years ago, 5 years ago, which is based on the information theory, which is, I'm studying it. It's not in my book, as you see, because it's quite novel, but it's quite powerful, okay? Instead, when we deal with optimization, what is the problem of optimization? The problem of optimization is that usually, when you formulate a learning problem, you want to minimize an error on something which is not convex. For example, you want to minimize the number of errors of a model. Okay? So an indicator function, correct or wrong. Unfortunately, this function is non-convex, non-differentiable, non-smooth, not Lipschitz. Okay? It means that you put it in a solver, and the solver remains there for 1 year, then goes down for 10 to the power of minus 100 after 1 year, and like this, okay? Then what you do is you try to replace that non-convex function with something which is at least differentiable, okay? So you can do gradient descent. Or convex, so you are sure that at least you reach a global minima. Maybe not good, but at least you reach a global minima, okay? So we can bound the difference between the function that minimizes that non-convex problem and the one that minimizes the convex problem, okay? Yes or no? The answer is yes, okay? In the sense that there are theories that can do something, okay? You can use something purely geometrical. These are the two techniques that are most used. One is the peeling technique, and the other one is the concave-convex programming, okay? Or you can do something against statistical, because there is a bound that does not, which is not always true, like in this case, you see? Here there is no probability. This distance is minus of a constant, okay? Here instead is less than something which depends of the confidence of your statement, okay? For example, you can assume something about the distribution of your data. For example, low noise. If you read some paper, you could have read something about low noise condition, okay? In practice, what we do? In practice, in order to handle the risk of deduction, you use cross-validation. Stop. Okay? You split the data multiple times and you pray for the best. Okay? Really, you pray for the best, because most of the time you look too much at the data, in the sense that you try to do something and then you say, okay, but I look just a little bit. So I test the algorithm A with cross-validation, then algorithm B. Yes, but then you look at the data twice, not one, okay? And then you cannot do it, okay? Instead, in induction, what you do is to put this term inside the formulation of your problem. So when you learn your model from the data, you don't simply minimize the empirical risk, but you try also to minimize the complexity of your class. And you can do it in three ways: Ivanov principle, Morozov principle, and Tikhonov principle. For sure, you heard about Tikhonov, okay? The Tikhonov regularization. But actually, the Tikhonov regularization is the father of Ivanov and Morozov, is the son of the Ivanov and Morozov regularization. In fact, you are used to this. You minimize the empirical risk plus some complexity term. For example, the mean square error here and the norm square of the weights here, okay? But actually, what you were doing is this. You try to minimize the empirical risk, keeping the space of function small, okay? And this is the, let's say, engineeristic approach. Or you have the practitioner approach. I don't care about the complexity, I just want the error smaller than something, okay? So find me the simplest function that gives me at least less than 10% of error, okay? So this is a bit more scientific, this is a bit more practical. In fact, Ivanov was a theoretician, Morozov was a practitioner, okay? And then Tikhonov arrives and implemented this because mathematicians do not like constraints, okay? And you remember it from Mathematics 1, because every time professor asked you to resolve a minimization problem with a constraint, you have to use Lagrange multiplier and you pray him for dying, okay? Instead, when the problem is like this, it's easier because you just have to compute the gradient and find when it is zero, okay? Instead, here is a nightmare, okay? Actually, the two are related because this is exactly the Lagrangian relaxation of the two principles above, okay? So it's exactly the same. Then, for optimization, how can we deal with it? In order to deal with the optimization, we have to do 1 hour, right? I talked for 1 hour. I still have 1 hour. 40 minutes to finish talking, right? Okay. So, most optimization problems in machine learning are non-convex. Full stop, it's true. It's like this, okay? Trust me, if you don't trust me, I will prove it later, okay? So, how can we deal with it? First thing is to relax with the convex or differentiable problem, okay? And so, for example, in SVM, you use the sequential minimal optimization algorithm, which is the most known algorithm for solving it, even if now people are using gradient descent because they have a number and they use it everywhere because everything becomes something to push, okay? Or gradient descent if it's only differentiable. And here there is stochastic gradient descent, mini batch stochastic descent, Adamart, and two million algorithm, okay? Then what you can do is to deal with the non-convexity but differentiability, okay? And in this case you can use the approach that I said before, constrained programming, gradient descent with multi-start, or greedy methods. For example, if you have used a decision tree, okay, the decision tree learning phase is a greedy method, okay? because otherwise the problem is NP, because there are the number of possible decision tree that exist grows exponentially with the number of nodes, okay? And finally, when you have to deal with non-convexity, with non-differentiability, what you can do, nothing, basically, okay? Apart from surrogating. Surrogating means you take some points of the function that you want to minimize, and you try to approximate it with something with this, which is at least differentiable, okay? Now, some example of what I said on recent topic that appeared in the literature. Shallow model. All shallow model can be written in the form of an Ivanov-Morozov of Tikhonov problem. For example, kernel method, you minimize an error subject to have a small norm of the weights, okay? The ensemble, the complexity, and the diversity of the classifier is the term which regulates the complexity of your space of function. In shallow network, you can do early stopping to reduce the complexity of the method. You can do weight decay, which is again small norm. Number of neurons is how to reduce the complexity of the space. And activation function. If you use activation function that are more nonlinear, the model becomes more nonlinear than more complex. If you use the ReLU, the rectified linear unit, okay, what you get is something easier. Okay? In rule-based method, you have the length of the rule, so how big is the decision tree. In Gaussian process, you have the kernel parameter, but in this case, everything is convex. And the lazy learner, for example, the k nearest neighbor, the k is the complexity of your method. K equal to 1, the most complex, you can learn whatever data set. K equal to big, the model becomes simpler. But SVM, for example, which you know it in this way, don't look at the details, it doesn't care, but you saw something like this if you have used SVM in your life, actually born like this, in the sense that this thing, which is the complexity of the space of model, was put as constraint in the original theory of Wapnick, okay? Now you know it like this because this is more easy to solve because the dual version is you have to minimize simply a paraboloid in a hypercube. But this is the original problem, okay? The deep models obviously have the same problem, just in a different form. The sense that the complexity is regulated, for example, by the type of layer. Convolution is a way to reduce the number of weights with respect to a fully connected network. But then there are long-term memory networks to deal with the temporal evolution of things. Okay? Transformer to further reduce, for example, the number of weights with respect to convolution. Okay? Then sparse spooling layers. Then you have activation, as I said before, the dropout. The dropout is nothing but a sort of norm regularization. If you check the original paper that developed this, show exactly that you can do regularization with dropout simply with a strange weight decay. And then there is overparametrization, which is a recent trend in machine learning, which showed that machine with many parameters works better than machine with less parameter, the so-called dual double descent regime. People, the oldest one, so the people close to the blackboard, now I'm also in the old one, are used to this, okay? If you ask to your professor without showing my lesson here, and you ask it, but if the error on the test set increases, do I have to go further in the number of parameters? It will look at you and it will destroy your libretto, it exists here, okay? And it will burn it, okay? They say, you are stupid, you don't have to talk with me, okay? The problem is that in machine learning, if you take a deep model, you will see that after this, if you increase the number of parameters after the interpolation threshold, so the error here is zero, the error will start to decrease again. and you will reach a minima which is better than this one. This is why the current model have millions of parameters to recognize a cat from a dog, okay? Or a flower from a poop, okay? Just because of this reason, okay?
What is in the origin of
the number of parameter, capacity, number of parameter, okay?
Why capacity?
Capacity is equal to number of parameter, capacity of the space, okay? But also working in this regime, which is the one that the old people do not like, they do not like it for a reason. Because, for example, there is the adversarial sample. It means that when you have so many parameters, small changes in the input will produce big changes in the output. The theory of chaos, blah, 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 okay? Which means that sometimes you put random noise on a cat and it becomes a banana, okay? For example, this. You take a panda, you put this noise over the panda, and you get a panda, right? And the machine tells you that it's a gibbon. Another how can we solve it? We need to make the problem more robust. So we are trying to tell to the machine that it doesn't need to classify just the sample in a good way. But it needs to classify all the sample around the sample that you have. Let's say, for example, a ball around a picture of a cat, all as a cat. Because in this way, even if you perturb a bit your cat, it doesn't become a banana, okay? The problem is that when you are in linear models, everything is good, everything is convex, easy peasy, a baby can do it, okay? Then, when you put non-linearity, so SVM, this is an SVM with a non-linear kernel, okay? It means that this cannot be solved, okay? And so, adversarial retraining, B-level optimization, nothing works, and everyone knows why, okay? Adversarial defense also provides side benefit in any case. In the sense that having this problem can bring some benefit, and the benefit is the fact that when you put a ball around the point, you are basically reducing the ability of your model to do strange things, okay? And so basically it's a form of regularization. So it means that you reduce the complexity of your model, because complex model that goes close to the points, and there are very, let's say, high frequency, will not be selected by the model. Finally, there is another hot topic now. I'm telling you this because these are topics that you can invest your career if you are a PhD student or a master's student, are not regressive learning. Now, machine learning is becoming a commodity, okay? Which means that in every consumer application, from the washing machine until the Google, people put machine learning inside for two reasons. One, because otherwise they don't sell anything, right? Second, because this technology is something that really works in some cases, okay? But the first reason is money, okay? And then people are learning a model, they put it in a pipeline with many other things around, okay? And then everything works, okay. But then we need to update the model. Then we update the model and nothing works anymore. Why? Because, for example, when you retrain the model, samples that are correctly classified before can be wrongly classified in the new model. Even if maybe the overall accuracy increases, not the same sample that I was guessing right before are still guessed right after, okay? Clear? Mm-hmm. Imagine to be in cybersecurity. After 5 years, as you retrain your model, a malware of 10 years ago is not anymore detected by your machine. What happens? That your company fails the day after, and then you close, and you can go and search another job, okay? So you want to learn your model in a non-regressive fashion. It means that I want to learn a new model that just improves on the previous one. And then there is a constraint here. I want to have zero error on the model that before the model, the older model have zero error, okay? And then things become more complex because now we don't want just to have a model with high accuracy, but also with high robustness. And then maybe some monkey that before were detected because I put some noise on a panda. My model now is robust, but then I retrain it and it's not robust anymore to all the perturbation of the data. And in fact, there is, for example, this website that is becoming more and more popular, where the people put not just the accuracy, but also the accuracy to perturbation. Okay? And people are trying to, so they're trying to optimize another accuracy metric. But now let's put all these things in the real world. Okay? And in the real world, what we have? We have data. And data are messy because we have facts, okay? So natural language processing, there are numbers, we are engineers, we like numbers. There are quantities, we like less because categorical variable, we need to do one-hot encoding and I need to write one line of code, I don't like it, okay? Information, again, something maybe that is coded in a way which is not purely mathematical. You have graph. How can I represent a graph in a vector? A nightmare, okay? We have measurement, okay? So things that are coming in streaming, so maybe with noise, okay? Or the sensor does not work. And then observation from humans that comes in different moments in time. So I need to know an information now because it's observed by the user, but the user is not a machine, it's a human. Then he needs to code it somewhere, and then there is a delay. And data are everywhere. Healthcare, transformation, industry, social networks, streaming services. And people are starting to know that even if you are doing, battles, it's not true that all the information that you need in order to produce battles are inside your company. Because maybe if you produce battle, but the battle are on Coca-Cola, and someone at the football league tells I don't drink Coca-Cola, the day after you have to produce half of the battles, okay? So social network influences also people that produce things that are completely disconnected from social networks. But indirectly, they receive the effect of these things. And so there is a common word that is used in every company, which is called the datification processes. So the fact that I want to take my company and make it as more data aware as possible, in the sense that I need to collect the voice of the customer, and the voice of the customer is in social network, is in the news, is when you look at the TV, is when you look at the news on the sheet that is on the appesi ai muri, come si dice? I cartelloni, come si dicono? Cartelloni pubblicitari. The advertisement, but the sheet advertisement that are on the streets. Okay. And for example, in China, there are cameras that looks at the people where they look in order to count how many people have looked at a particular advertisement, okay? Then there is the voice of the business, because okay, customer wants something, but I need to make them want a car, whatever color, but black, okay? And then there is the voice of the process, because there is someone that is working for producing what I need to sell to people based on the needs of the business, okay? And here there are humans, but also machines, okay? And the more data I am able to collect from these three actors, the more I can datify my world, and the more I am able to, probably, to predict something about the future. And the process of datification is complex because there is problem related to value and veracity, to the business value of today and tomorrow, because obviously for storing data I need to pay money, and how much is the revenue in 20 years, okay? For example, Google at the beginning made a sort of bet. They say, okay, now I start to collect data and offer free services to user, and for 3 years I will not gain money, okay? But now is the most valuable company in the world, okay? Because he got the intuition that data are not remunerative today, are remunerative tomorrow, okay? And there are all these parts that are important, for example, the solidification, the amplification of the value, the strategy, okay, the security of the data, because if there is a breach on this kind of data, it's a problem, both for legislation, obviously, but also for the value of my company. If Google is able to enter to the Microsoft server and took their data, tomorrow Microsoft closes, okay? And then there is also the problem of the open data, because now all the public administration in Europe are in some sense forced to give as much data as possible for free and as open as possible to people. And obviously, the more you are good at exploiting this data for your business, the more you have an advance with respect to your competitor, okay? In fact, the open data economy now is becoming one of the strongest economy in Europe. 300 billions of euro of direct market share of these things, okay? New jobs, new, and obviously saves in the economy. Imagine the lights, okay, and so on. And the open data are very useful because they induce you in better decision, in saving lives. Imagine all the small company in Italy, in my city, there are 3 spin-off that works on data about health, okay? Because obviously doctors do not have time to become data scientists, okay? And they do not also have the skills to do that, okay? And so we can help them in using the data that they produce to save lives, okay? And other examples. And all this mess about the data, and in particular the data that are open, induced the EU in creating a data act, so a regulation of fair use, reuse, and distribution of the data. And this is an important step for machine learning, because from now on, Europe is starting to create a fair ground for companies to use the data that exists to produce value. Because obviously now there is no fair access to the data, because just a few companies in the world are able to deal with this data, okay? But if you are forced, for example, if you use the data of a particular state, you are forced to give the part of the output of your value to other companies, you force basically the big companies to redistribute the knowledge and also the data to other companies, okay? But also AI is changing, because obviously AI is the tool for which you are able to start from raw data, extract information, knowledge, and wisdom. What is the difference between these 3 steps? Information can be just a dashboard, okay? You plot the data. Knowledge means that, for example, you can understand what will happen in the future or why something happened in the past. But wisdom is deduction, induction, abduction, okay? Wisdom is the way in which you say, okay, I can use this data to make things work in a way I like, okay? And in order to do that, there are different type of analytics. This is the way we call it in machine learning. There are the descriptive analytics, a dashboard, which answer the question, what happened, okay? Or why did it happen? What will happen in the future? And can I do something to make something happen in the future? Again, deduction, these two. Induction, abduction. An example of descriptive analytics is Google Maps. for the street congestion. This is Genoa. He remembers because he lived in this zone, more or less, okay? This is now the war in Ukraine, okay? This is Ukraine, okay? I would not go there with the flight right now, okay? Diagnostic analytics. A father received the news about baby product because their children bought a pregnancy test at the market. Or this, DeepMind, which reduced the amount of energy to cool the data center. Then there is prescriptive analytics. This is us, for example, our laboratory. Predictive maintenance on asset in the railway. This is something from someone better than me, which is DeepMind, okay? For example, predicting high disease. Here an example of prescriptive abduction. Cambridge Analytica, the election of Trump. They made the news feed appear at certain people in a certain way in order to polarize them toward a different voting preference, okay? And in the USA, Trump won by few percent, less than 1% votes. So even if your machine do not work well, it means that it needs to work 1% of the people, okay? You can change the chief of the USA. Another example which is more useful is how to accelerate the fusion using AI. They find a controller which is able to set up the plasma inside the magnet and control it in a way that is able to produce more energy. Artificial intelligence in the past was able to solve just simple problems, but now, as we saw before, is starting to solve more challenging tasks. But substitute intelligence is something that changed meaning in time. For example, me, but probably also you, lived in the world of Turing, okay? Turing is one of the fathers of artificial intelligence and is an engineer. And defined intelligence as the ability to replicate the human behavior. He designed a test, which is called Turing test, which basically is a way to detect something as intelligence. You put a machine and a human behind a black window, and you start to talk with the two of them, and you need to recognize where is the human, where is the machine. In 2016, the Turing test was passed. In 2011, Turing test was passed by a machine of IBM. Why? Because we are able to do intelligent machine? No, because the test was wrong. In fact, now the more modern way of looking at intelligence is the approach of Searle, which was disregarded because as engineer we tend to say to philosophers they do not understand anything, okay? But the truth is that he was right, and in fact he produced the test against the Turing test. You put in a room a computer and a human, okay? And you ask them to start translating a text from English to Chinese. The machine in 2 seconds solves the problem. The human is there after one year. Why? Because humans do not tend to solve the problem, tend to understand the problem, okay? And so he related the notion of intelligence to the notion of consciousness, okay? Which is something that we don't like as engineer because we cannot put x equal to f of something, okay? Instead, here we can, and so we are happy with that. But now, unfortunately, we have to go with Searle. AI not always had good times like today. This is a bit of history of artificial intelligence. It's born here. You saw the film about the Turing war, Enigma, okay? It's here. It's the first intelligent machine. It's his machine, okay? Then they started to be happy about this, but then they don't have enough power. Then neural network, again, natural language process, but nothing worked, then again down, okay? And then they started to go up, and now things are not going down. Why? Because computers are bigger, just because of that, okay? And we hope that here, we are almost at the peak, it will come out what? We like big things. What are the big things here? Big and cold things.
Quantum computing.
The quantum computing. The quantum computing will be the machine that will allow this curve to not go down. If quantum computer will not go down, there will be another winter, okay? But now we have this probably one of the most important moments in artificial intelligence. In 30 years, they will tell this story, like I'm telling you now about Turing, okay? If you look this minute of this this movie, which is the movie about a machine that won against the world champions of Go. Go is a play which is much more complex, but factorial more complex than chess, okay? And was always the subject of artificial intelligence because people wanted to challenge the most difficult problem in the world. And in 2016, the world champion, and not one of the world champions, probably the best world champion in history, Lise Dahl, is considered as the most important player of Go in the entire history because his way of playing Go was defeated by the machine 2 times over 3, okay? And there is this moment, which is in some sense scaring, if you really understand the moment, but from another point of view, is something that can really make enthusiast the humankind, in which the machine plays a move which a human would have never think about, okay? In the sense that the machine is not good just because he won against the human, but because he defeated the human in what the human is the best, inventing new things, okay? And in that moment, you really see in the face of the player, which is like, I don't know, you have Messi in front of a baby like this, and the baby starts to pass the ball in the middle of the leg of Messi. You really see the moment in which he comprehends that he would never be able to beat the machine, okay? But really, part that the guy went through a depression because of this, and so I'm not happy about that. But it's a real moment that if you perceive it, it's really emotioning, okay? But the problem is that there are also dark side of the use of machine learning. Bias in machine learning. Machine learning are starting to become to do things against black people, racist, and against women. And in most cases, against black women, okay? For example, this guy was wrongfully arrested because of face recognition in Detroit. There's problems. Signals that are detected as balls just because you put some paint on it, okay? Or bot that starts to become Nazist, okay? Or Facebook that in order to engage people in looking more news increases the hate speech, okay? And why this? Because when we construct a machine which is fully autonomous, like for example the news feed suggestion of Facebook, you take data and you induce a model. You represent the reality with constraint, and thanks to the prediction, you suggest proactive moves that you optimize based on the preferences, okay? And then you use data and inference, okay? But inside data, there are humans, and humans have biases. And statistics, through the inference, amplifies certain effects, okay? Creating a cascade effect. And unfortunately, this is a problem because we are used as engineers in a world of technology where the metrics are technical metrics, accuracy, computational requirement. I said a half lesson about this, okay? But unfortunately, these metrics, they do not tend to solve things in a good way. They just work. This is a philosopher, an Italian philosopher. Maybe you understand the phrase because Spanish and Italian is very similar. But that says that exactly this, the technical metrics do not tend to solve a particular problem. They just tend to optimize something. How? They don't care. Okay? And the second problem is that now we are starting to understand that the capacity of the machine are starting to influence the world where we live. Again, this phrase tells you that we do not have to think what the machine can do, but what we can do with the machine, in the sense of what skill can we give to a machine, but we need to start what the machine can do to us. Okay? And these human metrics, for example, that we are trying to plug inside the machine learning in the so-called trustworthy AI, are mainly these four: security, safety, robustness, explainability, fairness, and privacy. Okay? These are the four principles that we are trying to put inside machine in order to put metrics that are not just technical. And for this, we need to rely on the fundamental human rights. We need to start to think not anymore as just engineer, but also to ask help of the humanities. Okay? For example, these are examples of the current top neural network. Okay? You put a glass on the face of a guy, and then he becomes a woman or a man. Okay? You put a sticker, this is a simple sticker, on a stop, and the stop becomes a speed limit. Okay? And how can we solve this problem? We have our training set. We need to think about machine learning in the classical approach of software development, where there is a blue team and a red team, someone that wants to break the machine and someone that wants to protect it. It's the only way. We need to start attacking our model to try to force them into mistakes. Because understanding how they think and how they make mistakes, we can make them better. And obviously, there is a fundamental human right for robustness. Okay? Explainability, the top current recognizer between dog and wolf, a beautiful snow detector. Okay? If you try to understand what it tries to use for detecting if there is a wolf or a dog, he simply looks at the background. He doesn't even actually look at the dog. Okay? Explainability. He didn't learn anything, this machine. And obviously, there is a tension between explainability and accuracy. Because the more the model needs to be explainable, the more the model needs to be simple. But the simpler it is, the less accurate it is. Okay? And there are tools for addressing this issue. And the correlated human right. And then there is fairness. This is the machine that was used until 6 years ago in the US to decide if a guy needs to be kept in jail or it can go in probation. Okay? And it was detecting that basically the black should be kept all inside the jail, even if the actual reoffendence rate was the same in white and black. Facial recognition that are banned because of this guy arrested in New York, okay? And nobody is no more, the big tech no more develops face recognition software. And there is this nice Netflix series on this because there are a million examples. Irony of the fate, there is a researcher from Hawaii, okay? So lucky him, okay? Her, actually. That she is a black girl, okay, that discovered that the face recognition of the big tech are biased against black, and in particular, black girl, okay? And she is the reason why they stopped developing this software. But if we go in simple things without going in this level of complexity, if you search on google.it, so in Italian Google, amministratore delegato, so the chief of an industry, okay? You will see that the first 15 picture are from men. Why? The administrator and delegato is always a man. This is obviously a bias, a sociological bias, okay? But again, here there is a tension between accuracy and fairness. Because if I want to stick with the data, data are biased, and so I need to be accurate, and then I need to learn also the bias. So it means that we need to give up to a bit of accuracy in order to be more fair. Let's skip this, that I'm late. The last one, privacy, okay? Privacy breach can be volunteer, obviously, in some cases, but it can be also involuntary. For example, Netflix released its data to the community, so just to make a league between machine learner to detect the best recommendation system for the films, okay? And then people started to understanding what are the preferences of certain people in the USA. Why? Because the USA is not like Italy that or Spain that is difficult to find in a country code just one house, okay? But in the USA it's common. There are places, for example, where they extract petroleum, or in Alaska where there is one people in 10 million kilometers. And then if you give the country code, the guy is just one, okay? What are the solutions? There are all solutions, okay? All solutions are two, basically. You take the data, you corrupt them with noise, and then you release the data to whatever you want, okay? The more the noise, the more you protect your data. The other option is you keep your data in a trusted curator, okay? And then you release the answer with some noise over it. A noise which is large enough to protect the original data, but small enough to preserve the information, okay? This approach is a failure, in the sense that you can prove that you can bridge these two problems whenever you want, okay? The problem is just the money. So if here there is my data, nobody will do it, okay? But if here there is, I don't know, Putin, okay? There is a way to solve to find this data, okay? I say Putin because now it's the most important person to kill. You cut this part, okay? I don't want to die tomorrow, okay? Thank you. And there are the new solution. For example, I did a paper on this 1 year ago, which is really, for me, something that again created I was very enthusiastic about, okay? Obviously, you know that if you encrypt a file, you are sure that the data cannot be stolen, okay? You can with a quantum computer, but okay, again, NASA, Putin, okay? Now, can we learn on encrypted data? My answer is no, for the knowledge of 2 years ago, okay? The answer instead that now is yes. There is a particular way of encrypting the data, which is called homomorphic encryption, which allows you to train your model on encrypted data as they were in plain, okay? And so basically is the golden rule of every data scientist. I can access to whatever data, open, not open, with the ID in clear, because in any case the information is encrypted. And I can use the data of all over the world. Imagine the importance of this approach for medical research. I can use the dataset, European dataset, USA dataset, Italian dataset together and merge them together as I have all those data on my PC, okay? It will completely change the way in which we do machine learning in the next 10 years, okay? And obviously here, there is the final act of EU that after AI is out there from 40 years working, okay? And finally they managed to make the act on AI, which is a set of legislation for obviously put boundaries on the AI, okay? The obviously the hopeful message that I will send in this second part is that most people think that AI is developing a new form of intelligence, and then they are scared about this fact, as a bit we also are, okay? But the message that I would like to give to you is that it's not like this, okay? It's the opposite. It's that a new form of intelligence created AI. And it's you, because me, I'm already too old to discover something new, okay? But you have the opportunity, really, to make this phrase more true, okay? Because remember that AI is a product of humans, okay? And so how we created it, we are able to handle it, okay? Until we have this kind of intelligence where the real general intelligence will appear, I will be dead, so problem yours, okay? Okay, thank you very much, and I hope that you have enjoyed, and I'm here for questions, okay? It's 9, so probably there would be no question, but...
questions? Any questions? Alguna pregunta?
Yes, ma'am. Do you think that it's possible to learn from the model created by the AI?
I can't hear, sorry, I'm a bit...
Do you think it's possible to learn from the model created by AI?
Yes, sure, in the sense that we... This is what we need to do, in the sense that this is the scope of what we are doing now. No? We are trying to start to learning from how the machine learns.
Yeah,
okay.
This is a very amazing topic. It is the way to enhance the new artificial intelligence, but also to increase our own.
Absolutely, in the sense that every time science works in this way, you learn if you are a PhD student. We make mistakes and we learn from them. This is a quite big mistake, okay, true, but we are learning from these big mistakes, okay? So this is the basic of science, the scientific discovery, okay?
In this sense, it's related with the quantum computing, for example, that is able to analyze very quickly, very huge problems, a very different way to reason.
Quantum computing is a strange thing. I also did a paper on quantum computing, no? But it's a bit dark how quantum computing is really able to do now, okay? For my knowledge, it seems to me that it's very fancy, costly, and fast simulated on a leading machine, okay? Full stop, okay? So there is no quantum there. But in principle, quantum computing cannot break the NP problem, okay? Full stop. In the sense that, I don't know if you did some course on quantum computing, what you can do is to put a square root on the complexity of the problem, nothing else. So from the complexity point of view, you cannot change anything. But the fact is the constant in front of it, in the sense that you can do much more computation in the same amount of time, okay? A promising result was one of Google, that is, was the one really with some real result that was able to perform a computation that would have took something like the time from the beginning of the universe until now in doing, and he did it in 1 hour. And this was really promising. But after came out a paper that showed that with a trick on the algorithm on a real machine, that the same problem can be solved in more or less the same amount of time. So it's not clear what there is behind there. There are money, so probably there is something real, okay? But I don't know how much is in military forces, okay? Probably not, NSA has it and is using for real things. But at least in research for now, there are very big statements about research of big company, but then there is not real effect on my research, okay? And so I don't know how to answer, and this is why it's a hope, in the sense, I hope that it will happen, but for now it didn't happen.
Any more questions? Alguna pregunta?
something that we can see in real life? I mean, for example, the illness or sickness, I don't know. But do you think that it's proper to use the machine learning for to predict the something that it's related to the human mind? Because it's like, I think that every human is unique, and as you said, for example, to predict if someone is going to be a serial killer or something, it will not be totally exact. But do you think that using the machine learning is correct to use in something that's related to the human mind?
I take the Nobel and then come back answering to you. Okay, I don't know, obviously, full stop, okay? But my impression is that it depends, okay? And it depends on the application. When you say serial killer, the answer is yes. And there is no need in machine learning. There are personality tests that are able to detect with a certain level of accuracy, because obviously we are engineer. 100% doesn't exist, it's statistics, so it's a certain level. You are able to detect those things, okay? For example, I work with the human movement, and there is the so-called non-verbal interaction between people. So you can, for example, you talk with a guy, he doesn't open your mouth, but you know that you have irritated him, or a girl that wants that you continue to talk with her, okay? You don't know how, but you recognize this fact, okay? It's not verbal, okay? For example, I'm doing this study in this case, and with very good performance. For example, in case of dancer, there are in every dancing movement, there is one guy that is guiding the people, okay? And this guy is not always in the center. Sometimes he's in the back, like, for example, also in the music playing, okay? And then, for example, with machine learning, you can immediately spot where is the guy who is guiding the dance or is guiding the orchestra, okay? So, there seems to be large room for improvement in this sector, but obviously there are cases in which you can do it. But you can't do, right now, from what I know, just because you are not able to measure in the correct things. For example, there are guys that went completely crazy, okay, and then from one day to the other, kill some people, okay? But if I know, for example, that he lost his job, I would have been able to predict that movement. If I'm able to measure his blood pressure and detecting that there is a spot, so he got a small ictus in the brain, I can do it? Yes. So this is really a different way of looking at reality. There are two philosophies. One says the world is deterministic, is mechanistic. The fact is that if you're able to measure the correct things, you will be able to predict things. There is another part of the world which says, no, the world is not deterministic, there is the soul, soul is imperceivable, blah, blah, blah. Okay, they are correct, who is correct, who is right? Nobody, because there are scientific discoveries that supports both the two options. For example, quantum physics tells you that up below a certain level of granularity, you cannot describe the world with mechanistic rules, okay? So there is an option. And also the fact of God. People can say, yes, God exists or does not exist, and we can stay here until the rest of the world. But the basic question is the universe, where started? Nobody can answer this question. So the discussion from an engineer point of view is useless, okay? Both can be wrong, both can be right. If you live better knowing that there is a God, live with God. If you don't live with God, don't break me, because I just know how to solve linear equation, okay?
Going back to your questions, there's another ethical question about your point, because if you are able to detect a potential serial killer, there's an ethical question, because can you put in jail just to prevent that he's going to kill someone some years later? There's a novel, very famous novel, 1984, by George Orwell, who arises this kind of question. It's, I think the name is The Police of Mind, The police of mind is checking if you are going to kill someone in the future and put you in jail. So there are some ethical questions that comes from your questions. Sorry for...
No.
Okay. Any other questions?
And taking into account that right now the legislation tell you that they can't. Until he commits the things, you cannot do anything, okay? Yes.
The second one is, in your opinion, how do you think some problems like the trolley paradox? The trolley paradox, in which a train can kill people in one way or another, having ethical decisions, will result in a world where technology evolves significantly faster than law.
But you say, for example, when you have a car and both the two options kills someone, you have to decide the less. For
example, a child and
two people. For me, these are things very interesting, okay? But are silly question, okay? The question is, I take one city and put just autonomous car. I put a city and just real people. I wait 1 year, I look how many people are dead in the two cities because of car accident, and I decide the basis of that. Stop. This is my answer to this question. Because there is no real correct answer to this question. There is the famous paradigm, the axiom of robotics of Asimov, okay? Which it puts three rules that even a baby, my baby child, 1 year and a half, can do it. And then it puts the third one, okay? The fourth one. Okay, the decision should, finally a decision can hurt a guy, but not the humanity. Okay, beautiful. And then what does it mean, you don't hurt the humanity? Maybe by killing one people after 3 years, for example, now you kill Putin, and I don't know, in 3 years there is someone worse than him. It was good to kill Putin, okay? There is no answer to this. If you know the future, obviously everything is easy. You say, okay, I kill one of the two, I check the two options, I look in the future in 10 million years, and I look at what decision brings the correct answer. But in real world, you don't know. So even something that appears to be less evil in a particular moment can become the worst choice after 10 years, okay? So it's an unsolvable problem with the knowledge of a human, okay? At least in my opinion. Maybe they will contradict me in 2 months from yesterday, because I don't know it, okay?
Any other questions?
They want to go to it, I think. You cut really those parts.
Okay, there's no more question. I'd like to finish thanking all of you for coming here. And also Luca,
thank you with us. For inviting me.
I have learned a lot. Really, I learned a lot. I hope the rest of the audience have learned as me.
Did you understood the presentation more or less?
Yeah.
Okay. Some parts were tricky. Okay, but at least you have a reference. I will send the slides to Professor, and so he can share them with you. Okay.
Okay.
You already have them.
No, I got a draft. Sorry.
Okay.
The final version, okay. If you don't mind. Okay, I ask you to join me rewarding him with a big applause if you like it, okay? Thank you.